y'all. How are you doing? You doing all right? I bring greetings from the country of Texas. You know, we lend our credibility to the rest of the country, and we're not proud of it. So it's really a pleasure to be here to engage you on something that I think is really, really important. I'm here to do surgery. We're going to talk about heart transplants, among other things. And where I come from in Texas, heart transplants are a big deal. Houston was kind of one of the capitals of heart transplant work when all that stuff started back when I was much, much younger. And that's what I want to talk to you about. It's going to be two heart transplants. We're also going to talk about the culture wars. We're also going to talk about a change that needs to come and how we engage because of the way in which the world has changed. So I'm just going to dive right into this. And let me start off by saying it this way. The world is a very different place than when I went to seminary. I deal with stuff on a regular basis now that if you had said to me when I was a student at Dallas Theological Seminary, the other great seminary in the country, okay, that I would have said, you must be kidding. I remember a letter I got from a colleague that I had pursued doctoral studies with at Aberdeen. He was a former chaplain at Oral Roberts University, had come to do his work in theology. We lived in the same little village of 800 people. We graduated looking forward to ministry in the 1980s. We went out, and the first letter we get from this couple is about an elder on the elder board of the church that he's joined that underwent a same-sex operation and wanted to stay on the elder board. And so the question was, what would you do? Did you cover this in pastoral ministries? And what was really interesting about the letter is about midway through, the letter was from the wife. About midway through the letter, she was struggling with what pronouns to use to describe the person. Do you describe him in terms of who he was or who she has now become, et cetera? And I had to honestly say, we didn't even have a commercial on this issue during my time in pastoral ministries. And we were flying by the seat of our pants, and we thought, this is so rare and out on the edge. The only thing that can explain what is happening is that this church was in California. And yet, where we are, or where they were, is exactly where we are. Our world has changed, and the church needs to wrestle with changing not the message that it has, but thinking about how it delivers it because of how the world has changed. Let me explain to you why that's important and why simply going back to the greats of the past may not work. You see, what we've had in our culture is, at least in the West, is a culture that has been wrapped by a net that went around it that was Judeo-Christian in its roots and in its orientation. And so even if a person was nominally associated with the culture, there was that backdrop that caught them at one point or another, whether they were an active or engaged believer or not. That, ladies and gentlemen, is gone. There is no net underneath. It used to be that you could say, the Bible says, and that would be good enough in the culture because the culture had a respect for what the scriptures had to say. And we developed the habit that goes something like this. It's true because it's in the Bible. And we felt like we could communicate that both inside the church and outside the church, and that could work. That's not true anymore. That's not true at all anymore. And so the church has got to become a little more nimble. See, we have to change from thinking about it's true because it's in the Bible to it's in the Bible because it's true. Now, that's a different move. And what that move means is that we have to go about the business of beginning to probe and explain why the Bible addresses life authentically. And what it is about what the Bible says and the way it presents it and the way that it thinks and presents itself that makes for more effective living. that makes for people living out the fact that they've been made in the image of God more effectively. And we've got to recognize that this takes place in a world that has fallen and will never be perfect until he comes back. We will always have to deal with the tensions of life. Now, all of this means that as we lose this net, as this net has gone away, what has happened as we move into the future is we've gone back to the past. I like to say that the church is living in a moment in which we're going back to the future. And we have to come to the text because the church that existed in the first century was a church that had no real political power, people who didn't understand what they were about, etc., etc., etc. And yet they seem to have been pretty effective about carrying out the mission that God gave them to do. Maybe there's something to learn from that group. That's important because the models that tend to be put forward for how to do cultural engagement, either for us, tend to come from certain periods. They come from the Reformation, they come from the period of the Puritans, or they come from the period of the Great Revivals. That's where people are trying to take us back to. Or they might involve a figure like an Abraham Kuyper or something like that. Now, all these people from all those periods have great things to say to us, but there's one thing that's changed. The net that they operated under that was a part of the larger culture does not exist for us. And so some of what they could assume in their communication, we can no longer assume. So it's a challenge. It's a real challenge. So what I want to do is I want to take you back to the future, and I want to look at the way we've handled this recently. The way we've handled this, generally speaking, recently, is we have fought a cultural war. Onward, Christian soldiers, marching as to war, with the cross of Jesus going on before. All right. That's what we've been doing. We've fought the war. We've fought the cultural battle. And I'm here to say to you, we've risked making the war for the wrong thing. So I'm going to take you through a series of passages. We're going to be moving quick through several texts. And I want to do two heart transplants. This mission, should you choose to accept it. Turn with me to start off, and let's get our bearings by going to Philippians chapter 3. Philippians chapter 3. And if you have your Bibles, that's great. I happen to have my Bible on, I don't have a smartphone, okay? I have a spiritual phone because I have my Bible on my phone, okay? So, you know, the next time you're giving people a hard time because they put their Bibles on their phones, because it's kind of nice to have it there in your pocket and get to it, just remember it's a spiritual phone. It's not a smartphone. And if you turn to Philippians chapter 3, we get this as a reminder of who we are. Our citizenship is in heaven. And from it we await a Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who will transform our lowly body to be like his glorious body by the power that enables him even to subject all things to himself. That passage has two important points to make to us very, very quickly. The first is our citizenship is in heaven. We have a passport that's greater than our national identity. That identity is transnational. That identity connects us to people of many tribes and many nations. And we represent not only the God who has brought us into that citizenship, but we also represent the people to whom God has connected us with in the larger family of God. We should never, ever forget that. The second thing that this passage makes clear is that there's a transformation coming one day that's far bigger than anything we can do with a vote. It's why heart transplants are necessary. Because a lot of people live in very public and often secularized spaces, and your mission, should you choose to accept it, is to invite people into sacred space, out of that public space. That's what I want to be talking to you about. Okay, that lays the initial groundwork for what I want to say. Our citizenship is in heaven, And if we do not minister out of our identities in Christ with the reflection of the character that Christ seeks to give us, our words will be empty. Next text. This is the way this is going to go. 1 Peter chapter 1, verse 1. If you're into Bible drills, this message is for you, okay? 1 Peter 1:1 begins this way. Peter, an apostle of Jesus Christ, to those who are elect exiles of the dispersion in Pontus, Galatia, Cappadocia, Asia, and Bithynia. We are exiles. We're citizens of heaven, but we're exiles. We have been assigned to a foreign land. Peter says it this way. We are strangers in a strange land. So how do exiles live? Well, this is where Jeremiah 29 comes in. I told you, we're not stopping some places very long. Jeremiah 29. In Jeremiah 29, Israel has been taken, the Jewish people have been taken into exile. How many of you are experts on Babylonian culture? Do I have any Babylonists out here? Okay, just put those, be proud, put your hand, I understand the Babylonians. They're my brothers, you know? All right? How many of you understand the Babylonians? I will tell you, Babylonian culture was not stellar. It was not the most fantastic place to be taken to. We're talking to Aaron beforehand, and he said he's headed from here to Hawaii. Great trip, Aaron. Way to suffer for the Lord. All right? All right. Well, if you're going to Babylon, you're not going to Hawaii. And so in the midst of this journey, God tells the Jewish people how they're supposed to live in the midst of this culture as exiles. Verse 5, chapter 29 says, build houses and live in them, plant gardens and eat their produce, take wives and have sons and daughters, take wives for your sons, give your daughters in marriage, they will bear sons and daughters, multiply there and do not decrease, but seek the welfare of the city where I have sent you into exile and pray to the Lord on its behalf, for in its welfare you will find your welfare. We are to pursue the welfare of the city. How do we do that? By living out faithfully our Christian lives. Now, I said I was going to talk about the culture war, and to do that, I'm just laying some groundwork right now. This is a long, complicated introduction. If there's a homiletics professor in the audience, I apologize. Next, go now to Ephesians chapter 6. That's our war text. That's our spiritual battle text. But there's something very profound happening here that I'm afraid we've often missed. Chapter 6 and verse 10. Finally, be strong in the Lord and in the strength of his might. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. And then this is the verse I'm interested in. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, but against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers over this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Ladies and gentlemen, we are in a battle, but the enemy is not people. The enemy isn't even the people who disagree with us. The enemy are spiritual forces, and this is a spiritual battle. And so we better ask what the armor is that we go into battle with, and we better get the enemy right. Let me play with the cultural war metaphor this way. Yes, we're warriors, but we are not warriors trying to crush human enemies on the other side. We're more like a Delta Force that is designed to rush in and grab people who are in the grasp of someone else who's trying to do them damage. That changes the way you engage significantly. And what does that armor look like? This is where the other, I think, profound observation of Scripture comes through. Take a look at this with me. Put on the whole armor of God that you may be able to stand against the schemes of the devil. For we do not wrestle against flesh and blood, against the rulers, against the authorities, against the cosmic powers of this present darkness, against the spiritual forces of evil in the heavenly places. Take up the whole armor of God that you may be able to withstand in the evil day, and having done all to stand firm, stand therefore, having fastened on the belt of truth. So we do have content that we're dealing with. But having put on the breastplate of righteousness as your feet are shod, having put on the readiness given by the gospel of peace, in all circumstances take up the shield of faith with which you can extinguish all the flaming darts of the evil one, and the helmet of salvation, the sword of the Spirit, which is the word of God, praying at all times in the Spirit with all prayer and supplication, and keep alert with all perseverance. You know how we go to battle? We go to battle with the character that God gives us to do the battle with. We're supposed to be the people of God. We're supposed to live differently. We're supposed to show a different way of doing things. There's not one word in here about a political party or a vote. Now, I'm not saying that our public discussions don't matter. If you know anything about any of the work that I've done, they matter very much. But we've also got to put it in perspective. Our engagement matters in the public square because it's a way of showing that we care about people, and how we care about people, and what we care about, and that lives matter, and that people matter, and that reattaching them to God matters. And we do it with our character, and other people are not our enemy. Satan is. That changes everything. How much does it change everything? Well, you know we aren't going to be in any one passage for a long time, so turn with me now to 1 Peter chapter 3. This is a very famous passage that we're going to look at, and most people memorize a verse in the middle of this passage, but they have no idea what's going on around it. This is a very famous apologetics verse. You know, be prepared to give a defense for the hope that is in you. Very well-known text. Unfortunately, because we handle it as a memory verse and we don't look in the context, we miss some other things that are going on with how this is said that are profoundly relevant for us. Look back at verse 13. Now, who is there to harm you if you are zealous for what is good? Perfectly reasonable question. If you do what's good, surely your life will flow wonderfully. Now, who is there who will harm you if you are zealous for what is good? Verse 14 reminds us of the world that we live in. But even if you should suffer for righteousness' sake, you will be blessed. We live in a fallen world in which the chances of suffering for righteousness' sake are, let's shall we say, up at the moment. We should never expect people who have not been spiritually transformed to live like people who are spiritually transformed. But we hopefully can expect people who are spiritually transformed to live like people who are spiritually transformed. And in that difference is our political platform. Keep reading. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. Those are the people who are going to do you wrong. You're not supposed to be afraid. You're not supposed to be troubled. You're not supposed to be frustrated. You're not supposed to be angry. You're not supposed to be surprised. One of the things the church has done too much of, far too much of, in my view, in recent years, is we have whined. We have complained. We have shaken our finger at other people and forgotten that the solution is not in our confrontation. The solution is in our invitation for people to come into sacred space. And without it, you are going nowhere. And so we shouldn't be afraid. We shouldn't be troubled. Why? Because we're citizens of heaven. Our position is secure. Our identity is solid. It lasts for eternity. The devil cannot touch it. Greater is the one who is in you than he who is in the world. We have nothing to be afraid of. Have no fear of them, nor be troubled. But in your hearts, honor Christ as holy, always being prepared to make an offense to anyone who asks you for a reason for the hope that is in you. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Now, there are two parts of this. It's in the context of understanding that you're in the midst of this battle that you take up your apologetic role and you make your defense. It's the first thing. But the second thing to observe, just as important, is it isn't just what we say, it's how we say it. Look at what it goes on to say. See, most people get through verse 15 and they say, oh yeah, I'm prepared to make an offense for anyone who asks for the reason of the hope that's in you, and then they don't read on. Yet do it with gentleness and respect. Two words, two Greek words. Prautetes is one of them and phobos is the other. Prautetes means meekness, humility, gentleness. Phobos is the same word we get, the fear of the Lord is the beginning of wisdom, when the Old Testament translates that famous Old Testament verse into Greek. You fear God. It's a respect that you communicate. We're talking about the people who are challenging us. That's how we're supposed to interact with them. So sometimes I say, you know what? I look at the church and I go, you know, its message over here is pretty good, but that gentleness and respect thing, kind of missing. Because your mission, should you choose to accept it, is not just to challenge the world, but to invite people into a reconnected relationship with the living God that reconciles where they have been with where God can bring them to. Now, yet do it with gentleness and respect, having a good conscience, so that when you are slandered, those who revile your good behavior, that's a mixed up sentence. How can you be slandered for good behavior? Welcome to our world. So when you are slandered for your good behavior, those who revile your good behavior in Christ may be put to shame, for it is better to suffer for doing good than if it should be God's will than for doing evil, and then the example is Jesus Christ. If we are going to model what the armor looks like in the battle with the world, we need to become more like Christ. Now, I want to show you how pervasive the theme tone matters is in the New Testament when it comes to engagement. So I'm now going to take you to several passages, one after another, rapid fire, so you can see this. The next text, we're checking to see if you still know where the books of the New Testament are. Colossians chapter 4. In the context, Paul is asking for prayer. He's in prison. And he's asking for prayer that he might speak the word of the gospel, the mystery of Christ, as it ought to be presented. I figure if Paul needs prayer for his ministry, we probably could use some prayer too. And then it says this in verses 5 and 6, Colossians 4. Walk in wisdom towards outsiders, making the best use of the time. Let your season always, 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 that was emphatic, be gracious. Always. That's 24/7, 52, 365, except in leap years, 366. Can't take a day off. Let your speech always be gracious, seasoned with salt, so you may know how you ought to answer each person. Galatians 6. Galatians 6, verse 10. So then, as we have opportunity, let us do good to everyone, especially to those who are the household of faith. You know, sometimes I hear people making distinctions of how we treat people. You know, we're supposed to treat people, and, well, he's a brother. I can treat him that way. Persons outside the church, I don't need to think quite so hard about that. You know, Jesus dealt with that. Remember the ruler who came up to Jesus and asked the question, who is my neighbor? Now, you got to distinguish between the question that he asked and the question that he intended. Because in asking that question, what he was really saying is, are there people, some of whom are neighbors and others who are not? That's really what he's asking. And you know what Jesus did. He told the parable of the good Samaritan. And you know how that story goes. Jesus actually he answers the question, he answers it indirectly, because at the end he says, in effect, go and do likewise. He says, be a good neighbor, and oh, by the way, neighbors may come in surprising packages, such surprising packages that when the one asking Jesus the question was asked, who proved to be the neighbor among the man who fell among thieves? He couldn't say, Samaritan. He said, the one who showed mercy. Jesus says, be that person. Do good to everyone, especially to those who are in the household of the faith. Yes, inside the faith, they get more of it, but they get more of it. How are we doing? Doing all right? 2 Corinthians chapter 5. You've heard this text before, but I want to drive home a couple of points. Okay, if we're not warriors, if we're on a Delta force, then how should we think of what we do? I'm talking about two heart transplants. One is the heart transplant for the public at large as someone moves out of public space and is invited to come into sacred space to become a new creature. The second heart transplant is a heart transplant for the church. We go from thinking of ourselves primarily as warriors to thinking of ourselves primarily as ambassadors. Look at 2 Corinthians chapter 5. We'll start in verse 17. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. I'm going to come back to that. All of this is from God, who through Christ reconciled himself and gave us the ministry of reconciliation. Paul has a million words he could choose from to decide what single word am I going to use to describe the mission of the church. And he picks one, and that word is reconciliation. We have a ministry of reconciliation. That is, in Christ, God was reconciling the world to himself, not counting their trespasses against him, and entrusting to us the message of reconciliation. That tone that we're talking about is so important because it feeds into the ministry of reconciliation, which is our message, our hope, our invitation. Be prepared to give a defense for the hope that is in you. That hope is reconciliation with God. Therefore, we are ambassadors for Christ. There's your picture. God making his appeal through us. Listen to the tone of this. We implore you, that's how we're speaking to outsiders. We implore you on behalf of Christ, be reconciled to God. Do you hear the tone? Do you hear the plea? Do you hear the graciousness? Do you hear the gentleness of it? For our sake, he made him to be sin who knew no sin, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. Ministry of reconciliation. We're putting back together. We have a message about God putting back together what has been broken apart. There's another passage where Paul also has one word to summarize what the ministry is all about, and that's in Romans 1. In Romans 1, he says this, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God unto salvation to the Jew first and to the Greek." You know it, it's another memory verse. For years I read this verse improperly. I read it this way, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the salvation of God to the Jew first and also the Greek." I had no idea what the word power was doing in that verse, and yet power is the one word in that passage that Paul chooses to pick to summarize what his gospel is all about. It's all about power. But not power the way the world defines it. The way the world defines power is how I exercise power or control over you. The way this passage is defining power is it's about enablement, the capability to do something. And so you get it. I want to illustrate this as powerfully as I can, and I want to do it by telling a story. And I'm about to lay down on the job, but please bear with me. I want to take you through what Romans is all about. I want to put a picture in your head. And here it is. Here's how Romans begins if you think about it as a story instead of an epistle. See, Romans begins with us dead in our trespasses and sins. Can't hit that note. Now, here's the question. How much power does a dead person have? Zero. Nix. Nada. That's Romans 1-3. You have no power, no capability to live the way God has designed us to live because we're that flawed. Who steps into that breach? Who produces the heart transplant that makes a change that matters so that transformation can genuinely take place? The answer is Jesus Christ and Jesus Christ alone. That's Romans, the last part of Romans 3, Romans 4, and Romans 5. By the time we get to Romans 6, 7, and 8, we are walking with the Lord. And how are we able to have the power, the capability to walk with the Lord? Because he's given us new life and the Spirit of God that transforms us. Ladies and gentlemen, that is our message of the ministry of reconciliation. And that's heart transplant number one. So if anyone is in Christ, they are a new creature. And we're ambassadors of that message, which means we live in a foreign and strange land. And as we live in a foreign and strange land, our goal, should you choose to accept it, is to represent by our life and character and our way of engagement. God loves you and has a wonderful plan for your life. And we represent him in the country that we live in the space that God gives us, so that we can faithfully carry out the message and commission that he's given us to represent him. Being an ambassador as citizens of heaven, of the nation you represent, is the only way to culturally engage. Final passage, I think. 2 Timothy, little passage tucked away. Most people don't even know this passage exists. We've said things about character. We've said things about representing God. We've said about who the enemy is and how we should think about it. I've talked about two heart transplants. One is a heart transplant of the person who comes out of public space, who needs to be reconciled to God, and the presence of the Spirit of God gives them the power and ability to walk with God. And the second heart transplant is a heart transplant where I need to go from being a warrior to being an ambassador. Understanding that my battle is a spiritual battle on the one hand, but the people that I engage with are people that need to be rescued. I forgot to tell you one thing that I want to tell you. Back there in Romans, think about the picture of baptism for a second. And when we preach the cross, the gospel, ladies and gentlemen, is about more than the cross. It's about life. And I want to use baptism to picture this, okay? And for this picture of baptism, we're Baptists, okay? We're not sprinkling, okay, or anything like that. This is full dunking. Okay, we're going to get that weak stuff out of here, and here we go, all right? Picture baptism. The picture of Romans 6 is this. Imagine if baptism were, if the gospel were only about the cross. And you're baptizing. You're dead to sin into the water. That's not how Romans describes it. You're dead to sin, but what's the second half? You're alive to God. You're raised to new life. That's your heart transplant. That's the new creation. We have to preach a gospel that doesn't just forgive sins. We have to preach a gospel that talks about new life and a new way of living, a new way to engage. There are a lot of people out there in the world who do think that life is very dysfunctional. They don't call it sin, they call it dysfunction. They recognize it. You can take a horse to water, but you can't make them drink. But our assignment is to take people to the water and to represent him well. Okay, summary passage, 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 22. Look at this, it puts everything together for us. So flee youthful passions, pursue righteousness, faith, love, peace, along with those who call on the name of the Lord from a pure heart. How do you do battle? You do battle through your character. We do battle through our character collectively. Have nothing to do with foolish and ignorant controversies. You know that they breed quarrels. And the Lord's servant must not be quarrelsome, but be kind to everyone, able to teach, patiently enduring evil. It may come with the space. You know, I'm reminded of the community in Acts 4 when Peter and John have just been released from prison and they pray. And what do they ask God for in the midst of rising persecution? They do not pray to nuke the enemy. They do not pray to escape the persecution. They pray for faithfulness and boldness. Be kind to everyone. Be kind to everyone. Kind. That's that same word, proutitas, we talked about earlier. Able to teach, patiently enduring evil, correcting his opponents with gentleness. There it is again. Not only what we say, but how we say it matters. God perhaps may grant them repentance leading to a knowledge of the truth, that they may come to their senses and escape the snare of the devil. Mission, should you choose to accept it. After being captured by him to do his will. Well, there it is. Two heart transplants. Two. One for them and one for us. Only one of the things we have to avoid is being excessively them and us. We're all in the same boat, needing the Lord. The heart transplant for them is an invitation to come out of public space, a secularized space, an isolated space, a contending space, a non-reconciled space, and live in the continued tribalism that we see from day to day. Or to come into sacred space and let God go to work on the heart. Without that, our expectations for what it is people are capable of doing when they live should not be high. Great Expectations is not the title of this book. The second heart transplant is the one the church needs. Desperately. Desperately. We do have a battle and a war. It's a spiritual battle. It requires prayer. It requires character. It requires gentleness. It requires love. It requires a message that points to the reconciliation that's possible in God and in Jesus Christ. And the solution is not to take the kingdom out into the world. The solution is for the world to step into the kingdom. Let's pray. Father, you love us deeply, and you have put us here to represent you as citizens of your kingdom. Help us to do that well. Help us to fight the battle through character and prayer through engagement, teach us how to lose well sometimes. Teach us how to be faithful and bold. Teach us how to be gentle and respectful. Teach us how to take the challenge of the gospel, and it certainly is a challenge to every one of us, because only you ever lived out that challenge well. Teach us how to take that challenge of the gospel and deliver it with an invitation that says, God loves you so much, he gave of himself so that you could come to know him. And may we rejoice in the position we have as your children, despite all the noise that is around us. And may we relish in the assignment of being your ambassadors, for it is a privilege to represent the one true, living, and merciful God. In Jesus' name we ask it. Amen.